So we've been talking about one to many relationships for a while as a relational. There is one more sort of core representation that we have to figure it out and talk about. That's many to many relationships. And there's lots of situations in this world where these arise. The one we'll talk about is from a data model from some open source software that I write. Matter of fact, it's the software I write that I use to host my web applications for everybody website called Sumi. And it has to deal with different courses and people in those courses. And so we'll see these kinds of connector tables. The thing that we've been doing up till now is what's called a one-to-many, and that is when we have an arrow, when you look at those things, they'll often put some kind of annotation. And so this is like zero or one, and this is many. And so there can be many tracks for one album, many in other, many albums for one artist. And so there's this end is a zero or a one situation where there's one row here, but many rows. So you can have many foreign keys. That's the duplicates, right? So you can have one, 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 one. This is the many in the track table, and that points to exactly one key in the album table. And so that is reasonable. Here is this duplication, right? We get this duplication 111, and there is one there. And so actually I probably should have this arrow going the other way. This is the many side, and sometimes they'll draw it this way. So if you have a mother with many children, there is one on one side and many on the other side. And so this is another one of those natural relationships that that we have to represent, right? That's a normal kind of thing, and that's what we've been representing up till now. But, and frankly, if you've been playing along, artist mapping to albums, well, that's really a many-to-many relationship, and we kind of oversimplified it so that we could make it here. But like books and authors, or artists and albums, there really is what's called a many-to-many relationship. And the simplest way to think about this is there's kind of an infinite number on both ends, meaning that any number. An author can be part of any number of books, and a book can be written by any number of authors. And there is no way with a single table. So if we're going the way we've been doing it, you can't take one table pointing to another table. And so we end up with this table in the middle, and we call it a junction table or a join table or a many-to-many table. And we basically break this many-to-many relationships into two many-to-ones. And so this is a one, and this is a many, and this is a many, and this is a one. And so by having a many to many, we have a way to do this, and then we allow duplication. We don't allow duplication, so author one can be part of book one, author one can be part of book two, author two can be part of book three, author two can be part of book five. What we don't allow is duplication like one one. So we actually make a uniqueness constraint typically on these tables. So, but you can certainly ha so that's not allowed. But we can certainly have duplication in these columns. We can have duplication in these columns. But what we do is we make the primary key in effect be the combination of those two columns, and we'll talk about that in a bit. But the key concept here is that we need to add another table, right? We need to add another table. We can't do it with just two tables. We have our books table, and these books is classic that has a primary key, an ID field, a primary key, and away you go. And so this is what it looks like, right? We sort of draw a logical diagram that has this many to many on both sides, and then we make this table in the middle. And it doesn't have a primary key. It's rare to put a primary key in here. What we do is we make the primary key, our uniqueness constraint and primary key be the combination. So we can have duplication in user ID, we can have duplication in course ID, but we can't have duplication of the combination of user ID and course ID. And so that becomes the primary key. It's like a composite primary key. Another important thing is sometimes we actually model a little bit of data at the connection point. In this case, we have a series of courses and a series of people, and we could have a role. So this role could indicate whether or not this relationship, it's not about the course, it's not about the person, it's about this membership that they have. Is that membership a student membership or a teacher membership? And so you can sometimes, but you don't model anything about the user, don't model anything, you only about the relationship, this connection, because there's many, many connections. So let's take a look at some code that we're going to play with now. We're going to create our user table. By now, I hope this is relatively straightforward. We got a primary key, yada, yada, yada. We got some uniqueness constraints, for email and away we go. So we set those two up. Those are no different than if we were doing a one-to-many. The interesting part now is what we do in the membership table. And so we certainly create a foreign key, and we don't put a uniqueness constraint on that because we allow duplication in the user ID column and the course ID column. We do mark them as foreign keys using the normal thing. We say the user ID points to the ID, the user ID column in the user table, et cetera, et cetera. So we put these two things in. That's helpful with our on update clauses, of course. And then what we say is the primary key is what we're saying here is the combination. The primary key is the combination of user ID and course ID. And that adds a uniqueness constraint as well. It says, okay, we're not going to allow 1-1 to be in this more than one row. Okay, so that's the picture of the tables that we build. It's not that different. It's just like we got two foreign keys going in opposite directions and no primary keys. And we don't have a primary key, but the primary key is a combination of the two keys. So that's good. So to fill this data up, we will insert the data into the courses, right? Insert users into courses. Again, we don't put the primary key in. Don't have to because it's auto increment. And we'll do these statements, and we'll get the primary keys now associated with these people. So that's just filling that data in and taking a look at it. And then all we have to do is create the connections. And so these connections are all numbers because they're two foreign keys and a role. And so if we take a look now, we're going to insert into this member table the user ID, the course ID, and then the role. These are the column names. And then the values here are user one, course one as instructor, user two, course one as student, user three, course one. And so this is where we're allowing duplication, but we're not allowing the duplication of those combinations. So user one is in course two, user two is in course two as the instructor, user two is in course three as the instructor, and three, three. So we got lots of duplication vertically, in either of these columns, but we have no duplication vertically for the combination because the primary key of that table is the combination of those two values. And you know, it's really not all that complex once you get used to it. It's just really two foreign keys kind of pointing in opposite directions in this memberships table. And when we get done with this, the membership table is just a bunch of numbers that captures it. And we don't have neither of those two things. Neither of these two things are the primary key. No, that's a foreign key. That's a foreign key, right? They're pointing away. And then we modeled the role here. So that's the data that we end up with. These tables are very efficient because it's all numbers. It's three numbers in this case. I hope there's sometimes you put a bunch of more data there. But in general, you just put three numbers or a couple of numbers there. And they're very fast to scan, very fast to join against, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And so once we have this, the join is pretty straightforward. The thing you think about as you're joining is in the one-to-many, you would join from this to this, and then you get like the genre names. But what we have to do here is we kind of join through the table. So if we're going to connect the users and the courses, we have to go user, membership, course. So we're joining through the table. We're using it to pull these records together to connect them because it's a connector. And so the join is pretty straightforward. Select username, member role, course title. That's the information we want. And we're actually pulling something out of this middle table. We're pulling this role column out. We're going to sort of join through from the user, joined through, I say, member, join with course. And then the on clauses are just the modeling of the connection, which is connecting the user ID and the course ID, right? User ID and course ID are connecting. And so it's just a simple on clause. Member user ID is equal user's user ID. Member course ID equals course ID. The obvious connection, if you name the fields the way I suggest you name them, you're all good. And then I'm just going to order these things by the course title and the member role descending so that the teachers come first. It'll do it mostly by course title, then it'll do second by role, and then within role, it'll do it by username ascending. And so that way I get, that's my little trick there to get the teachers to show up first in each class. So there's the PHP class, there's the Python class, and the SQL class, and you see all those memberships. And again, this is simple. If you figured out everything we've done so far, it's not that hard. And so if you take a look at my this database, you'll see in a nice data modeling thing where we see here, and each of these data modeling has a different way of doing this. This is a one relationship. It could be a zero or one. It may or may not be there, but in this case, it's going to be a one relationship. And this is a many relationship. That's an infinity or a many relationship. So if you model this table in some kind of an SQL modeling environment, it will see all the things that we've done. And in effect, what we built is a many to many relationship between these two tables. I'm not a very good artist. Okay, so. And if you take a look at the data that I data model, you can see that my data model has a too many to ones because it has a many to many relationship. It's a many to many relationship between users and context. Context is my word for course, because it could be groups or could be sites or whatever. And there's two foreign keys, and you sort of see that, and away you go, and we get that many to many relationship. So this is really common. I do a lot of work in educational technology, so it's not surprising that I use users in courses. So to wrap this series of lectures up, databases are really important. And you might think that this is a trade-off and that you can say, you know what, boy, that's a lot of stuff. I don't want to do it. What you find is it doesn't take very long before your data gets so large that you can't do things, especially with online applications. You can't do things in a quarter of a second by reading data. If you just have one file to read and it's small, that's fine. But if you've got to read through and discard a bunch of information, reading flat files discarding information is really slow. Whereas databases leave these, by the time you've done all this indexing and primary keying and all that uniqueness, it's left trail. So it knows how to get to stuff super fast in ways that you don't understand. So in summary, it allows us to scale to reasonable and very large amounts of data. It means it's the way to build online applications. There's no real other good way to store it. Things like NoSQL, which you might hear of, they're good for some things, but the kind of shapes of data that we're doing, NoSQL actually is weak at. NoSQL is better for lots of documents with relatively low amounts of structure and links between the documents. And so we have to make a really strict contract. We build a really strong schema. And the schema decides what we show and don't show. And by giving a rich contract, we really can make it so the database can highly optimize using techniques that we can't even imagine to make this stuff go fast. And so you've learned a bunch about database design, but I will tell you that you can always learn more. And what I really enjoyed in my own career was the time at which I knew enough to talk to people who were smarter than me. And that's kind of what I'm trying to do here, is get you to the point where you can be in a room and then sort of be amazed when you realize, oh, wait a sec, I learned something really cool about databases because I understood the basic language of it, and now I'm listening to someone who is super awesome and way smarter than me. So. Hope you find it useful. Cheers.